Infectious diseases were supposed to have disappeared by the end of last century, according to the Surgeon General last century. And it was reasonably optimistic because we were just starting to have streamlined public health policies, improved hygiene around the world, and vaccines and drugs. And we thought that we could continue just along that line and by the end of the century be pretty much safe against any emerging pathogen. And it turns out that up to this day, we only eradicated just one human pathogen. So it's this very powerful force of nature that actually have shaped human history. And one key process that governs if an epidemic or a small outbreak will become an epidemic or if an epidemic will become a pandemic is transmission. And fluids shape transmission. Fluids are everywhere, and pathogens are always in fluids. After the SARS epidemic hit, it was midpoint during my PhD, I realized that I really wanted to move into an area where I could have an impact in public health. And coming from fluid dynamics, what I realized is that there were critical processes that we really did not understand that well. The focus was still on this static description of isolated drops being emitted from coughing, sneezing, talking, etc., that is rooted in works of Wells from the 1930s. Now, what we found in our earlier research is that these drops are not coming out isolated. It's a cloud that's coming out, a cloud of gas that is turbulent, high energy, and carrying them forward much further than this 1 and 2 meter rule that has been applied up to now. And another very important aspect is that this cloud dynamics completely changes the persistence of the drops in terms of distances, timescales, heights of where these drops can go and be sucked in the ventilation system. You can also start thinking about why some individuals spread more than others. What are these properties that could make them be more efficient spreaders? Another example of how fluids and health come together is for food safety and agriculture. And there, we have looked at the process of rain-induced disease transmission. And so when drops basically hit leaves that are contaminated, there is an empirically known process of transmission that occurs in the field. But that also occurs in nature, of course, in the wild. But up to now, that was also a black box. Like for transmission between humans, the transmission through the splash process that was pretty much conjectured. And that's something that now is leading to additional research where we're looking also at other aspects of food safety. So the pipeline of fundamental research and rigorous research to elucidate how things work so that we know that it's not just we were lucky to discover a pattern, but we understand it so well that when we turn the knobs, we control that pattern. With an increase in population worldwide, an increase in connectivity, an increase of drug resistance of pathogens that we understand, we are at high risk by midpoint of this century of going back in a pre-antibiotic, pre-vaccine era as a global population. So my job, besides doing research, teaching, and trying to mentor these bright minds, is to raise this awareness and bring that to the attention of the policymakers and the decision makers at the global scale in terms of global health, and in terms of also revisiting our current recommendations and regulations about transmission.